Hello, and welcome to the commentary for When We Met the Doctor, which is the first proper episode of Series 5. And here are my two logos, which don't exist anymore. And then we open with a previously of everything that happened in On the Good Earth. Now, I decided to do this because I knew the series wasn't going to be released regularly. So, with months between episodes, I thought having previously trailers for important events that you are required to know to watch the episode you're about to watch would help anyone watching if they hadn't seen On the Good Earth or if they'd just forgotten, because this came out 4 months after. And now we go to our new companions, James and Jasmine. And
yes, it's your phone.
I'm really pleased with these companions, and I think they are the best characters I've made, really. Because from this scene, they are established as people. They're not established as bizarre characters that are looking for adventure or everything. They are just two people living their lives. This conversation is about finding jobs, which a lot of these two's lives have been drawn from my own experiences. So I think that's helped a lot with this series and making them feel realistic enough that you believe they are. Now here we have the TARDIS, and this is obviously the first glimpse we get of that in the series. And you know it's the TARDIS because James says that there's never been a police box on the corner of the street.
So what were you saying about a police box?
And then it's gone. And this just sets up Jasmine's story for this episode, really, of seeing the TARDIS, and James doesn't really believe her until he sees it for his own eyes. And here we have our new title sequence, which is, I mean, it's basically regraded from what it used to be, but we have new names with the lightning, and it's only used for this episode because I then made a new set for episode 2. I really liked this logo and how it came in and then sort of wiped away. And I really like this text as well. It's a shame I didn't use it for longer, really. I kind of wish I had.
Then I said there's absolutely no way you can do that and not tell her. She's bound to find out one day, and it'll be better coming.
And much like the first scene, this one also sort of grounds them as characters because they're talking about different people and gossiping, and I think it just it makes them feel fresh and real. And I'm just really proud of this episode for establishing them. Because it's not something I'd ever really bothered with before, establishing the characters. They just sort of appeared, went on adventures, left. But these two have a real story and a connection. I hate this scene because I didn't bother to cut off the edges for the set, and I really regret it now, looking at it, and it just looks awful. Maybe if I do a updated effects sort of thing in a few years' time, I'll go back and I'll refilm that and make it look a bit better, a bit tidier.
There's nothing there.
And again, we've got another clip of Jasmine seeing the TARDIS, and then by the time she alerts James to it, it's gone again. And then even after she's seen this, James continues to gossip on anyway, because they're just people. That's what people do. There's nothing extraordinary in James's eyes, but Jasmine knows there's something wrong. Something I enjoyed doing this episode is setting it over a good few months, so it's not just a case of they see the TARDIS, the Doctor's there, they travel with him. I wanted it set over a few months of Jasmine not really trusting what she's seeing and trying to get James to believe her, but he doesn't until this point. And this is the first time we see the Doctor in the series, looking quite mysterious. And that's what I was trying to play with here, is that you don't really know what he's up to at this point, because The last time you saw him, he took a piece of the cyber planner from the Cybermen. And now he's going down this manhole and you're not really sure what he's doing. But Jasmine certainly wants to find out, so she goes and investigates. This scene looks awful as well because of the edges on the sets. I don't like how out of focus that is either, and I didn't realise until I got to the editing stage that it was so out of focus, so I couldn't really change it by that point. I quite like this scene as a scene, and I think the music looks good. I'm not a fan of this shot here with the Doctor. I think I could have done that a lot better. But it's done now. So now she knows that he's out of the TARDIS. She goes and finds James. Who still doesn't believe her because the TARDIS is gone.
Okay, this is getting ridiculous.
Which, in hindsight, doesn't actually make any sense because the Doctor's still down the manhole. So the TARDIS should be there, really.
What?
But
look at the dream.
I've only just realised that. And then the Doctor pops himself back up from the manhole.
Ah.
And this is the first time they meet. Right. I think it's a really sort of...
Usually
pure scene.
As the general idea, yes.
Because at this point, the Doctor is travelling alone. He doesn't want any more companions. He's lost Clara. And even though that's been 2 years, it has only been a few episodes.
Yes,
he's lost River in that time as well.
How could we not?
So I think he's just secluding himself from everything else. He doesn't want new friends because he knows he'll just lose them again.
Go back to bed, forget you saw me, forget you saw the box. Get on with your lives. Goodbye.
You never even asked our names.
It's not important, I don't need them.
It's James and Jasmine.
I think this becomes quite a sweet thread throughout the episode as well about not needing to know their names, because if he knows their names then that means he's attached to them and he has to look after them and care for them, etc. And then he gets to have the lovely moment at the end of the episode where he calls them by their names.
This isn't what I ordered.
Now this is obviously the second piece of the cyber planner. There's not really a reason why it shows up at James's work. It just does.
You'll see when you get here.
But it was just a way to bring the Doctor to the two of them, and then for them to be able to follow him and go to the TARDIS.
Yeah. What do you think it is?
I don't know. It looks weird. Like it's sort of...
And here he is again. I'm not a huge fan of the way this scene was filmed because it's quite limited in terms of the sets. Because I couldn't really find many office-y images online that would fit together.
This is it.
And...
Sorry, can I help you? Oh, it's you two, isn't it?
Yeah, it's us.
What is that thing?
Nothing you need to worry about. If I explained what it is, you'd only start panicking.
But why do you need it? It was delivered to James.
And now I'm going to deliver it somewhere else. See ya.
So obviously the Doctor tries to escape from them, but they aren't having any of it.
I'm not letting him get away this time. Come on!
Now this scene I think is quite nice. Just, it's their first sort of confrontation with the Doctor and... You don't really know what he's up to still, so you do wonder what he's hiding. And I think they're just interested in finding out more about him, because she keeps seeing this box, but she's no idea how he keeps moving it or what he's
doing
in it.
No, you can't go in there.
And then we get the first TARDIS scene of the series, and the first TARDIS scene for James and Jasmine, which I think is a really nice moment where they just walk in and... They're taken aback by what they're finding.
What the
fudge? Yes, I know. It's bigger. It's like Narnia.
I quite liked this.
I'm getting that vibe too.
Few moments of they never say it's bigger on the inside.
The whole world inside.
Seriously. And it, It irritates the doctor quite a bit that they don't say it's bigger on the inside. But I was very conscious about the fact I did not ever want them to say it's bigger on the inside, because it's such a cliche, and it is a very Doctor Who cliche now. But I just didn't want it. Because realistically, if you walked into the TARDIS, you probably wouldn't say those words. So I wanted them to compare it to something in real life. So they compare it to Narnia. And I think that's a better way of looking at it than, oh, it's bigger on the inside.
Second mortgage to run this thing.
It doesn't run on electricity. The TARDIS is powered by rift energy.
Meaning what?
Meaning that it doesn't actually cost me anything besides a few minutes of my time every so often when she needs refueling. The TARDIS isn't an appliance. The TARDIS is a ship. You don't just pop 50p in the meter every time you want to go somewhere. Ship.
I think this scene drags on a little too long, but for the context, I think it does need to be there.
What gave it away?
What's happening?
Well, you know how I said you caught me in the middle of something. Yeah? Well, this is the thing.
Again, if I did sort of updated effects and shots and everything in a few years' time, I'd probably update all the TARDIS scenes from the first half of the series up until the Dollhouse, because I don't like the TARDIS scenes in any of this. So I think I'd have to adjust those if I was gonna ever consider updating it.
Okay then. There are some DVDs on the bookshelf. Should be something there to occupy you. Game of Thrones, Thomas the Tank Engine, I'm sure you'll find something. Wait, I didn't say I wanted to stay here. You seem to be the only one with any answers. I'm not letting you out of my sight. And that's an opinion you don't seem to share?
Ugh, fine. But if something happens to me, I'm holding you personally responsible. Both of you.
Right then, let's go. Wait a minute, you still don't know our names? Again, I don't need them. I've no intention of getting attached to you. If I learn your names, that would be me taking an interest.
And there's that names thread again.
It's better if I remain detached until I can get you both back home.
So now we are on a spaceship, which is orbiting Saturn. I quite like this shot of the fan cutting the light out.
How did we do that? We're on Bridge Street, and now we're... Where are we?
Computer says 36th century. We're in orbit around Saturn. It's a bit desolate, though. Could use a lick of paint. But besides that, everything seems to be working fine.
And obviously, this is the same ship that features in End of the Line, which you'll know once you've... by the time this comes out.
Let's go and have a look about.
And this is it at a later point in time, after the Cybermen attacked in that episode. Which, I always knew I wanted to do something at the beginning of the series that would tie right into the end of the series directly. I think this was the best way I could go about it.
So, we're on a spaceship with a criminal. Great.
I like this idea of James being quite negative towards the Doctor. And he constantly questions him and makes sarcastic comments, and I think that's part of James's character, because that's part of me in real life. I make a lot of sarcastic comments, so I wanted to transfer that directly into James.
Blending best with the surroundings, but it's stuck in the shape of a police box. Yes, in the shape of a police box.
Can't you fix it?
I could, but I've never gotten around to it. Besides, I quite like it. Has a perception filter, so no one really pays any attention to it. You must have quite the eye for detail. Most people just walked right on by.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of cool. Retro and all that.
You're enjoying this way too much.
Oh, come on, James.
See, he doesn't like the fact that Jasmine's enjoying it, but he's...
She has a point. I've shown you something.
Very negative towards it, really.
The whole time. Well, I'm sorry if I'm a bit sceptical. It's just all a bit much to process. I can't help it if I...
Shh! Did you hear that? He's even shut up by the Doctor, which... They don't get off to the best start, the Doctor and James. And I think it's sort of a Doctor and Nardole type relationship. Because they have a rocky start, but they do warm to each other in the end, which
Hello there.
Is what I was aiming for. So these are the only surviving victims of the cyber attack.
Like the place was abandoned.
Now, I decided not to include these characters in End of the Line because I wanted different characters in the finale than were in this.
Men made of metal.
Cybermen.
Yeah, how do you know?
Because I'm currently in a race with them to find parts of the cyber planet which have been scattered all across time and space. Is that what the thing that was delivered to my office was? Yes. And now it's here, sat in the TARDIS. The Cybermen must have gotten the timing a bit wrong. How long ago was...
Obviously, we know they didn't get the timing wrong. It was the biodamper that sent the signal to the Saturn orbiting space station. That's why they went there in the first place, but obviously the Doctor thinks... The Cybermen just got the timing wrong. He also wonders why the TARDIS brings them there, but it's obviously to show them what's going to happen and gives them a bit of a glimpse into the future, even if they don't know it yet.
I'm still not sure what to think. Spaceships and time travel and everything you grew up believing as a child. And it's real. It's happening right now.
I always quite liked these few little lines of dialogue exchanged between Jasmine and James about... understanding what's happening and the TARDIS and time travel and everything like that. I think that's quite a nice few little exchanges.
Yeah, but it takes a while for them to get all the way out here. They're due pretty soon, though.
Okay, well, I'm sorry. I need to go now because I've got very precious cargo on board my ship. Cargo I can't risk losing. I'm sorry about what happened here.
I understand.
Okay, you two, with me. The Cybermen attacked this ship. They were looking for the piece of the Cyberplanet on board the TARDIS. They were just a week or so early. That much I understand. But there's one thing I'm not getting.
Again, if I was going to go back and re-edit this in any way, I'd probably use this track a lot less because it's used in this one. It's used two or three times in Engulfed. It's used in The Game of Life. So I tried to steer clear of it now because I've realised I've used it a hell of a lot.
Upgraded and put in a suit of metal. Immortality and armour. Lacking any emotion. Bit rich coming from you. Anyway.
More sarcastic comments.
Seriously, we have names. Anyway, you two, time to go home.
I like how the Doctor's sort of softening to them, but he's still trying to keep up that wall of detachment from them. Technically, I didn't show you any of this. So he proceeds to just take them home anyway.
That's that, then, is it?
That's that. I'm sorry.
I'm not the biggest fan of these lines between the Doctor, James and Jasmine, but I think it serves its purpose well enough. They just kind of walk off, and I don't know, I don't really like that. I do like the TARDIS sort of telling the Doctor off, almost.
Oh, shut up! You know I can't do this, not after everything, and especially not now. I have work to do. Maybe you're right.
So how are things going with you and Lee?
When I wrote this scene, I knew when I wrote it, the music I wanted over it, and there's actually a little edit note in the script to have this track play over it.
James West, Jasmine Jones.
And this is the sweet little moment where he gets to address them by name.
Wait, you... Our names?
Yeah. And they're sort of almost touched by that. Well, like, they've been trying to get him to call them by name for the whole episode, which for them is months.
You're trying to say you're attached to us?
But he only does it at the end, when he realises that maybe he does need new friends to... just be with him, really.
One can never tire of that privilege.
And then he offers them all of time and space, which is quite an offer, really.
What?
See it. And all the other stars and all of time and space. All the things that ever happened and all the things that ever will. You can see anything and everything and be back quicker than you.
That image that's behind the Doctor there is actually a screen grab from the pilot after Bill runs out of her flat after seeing the water creature.
Why not? You in?
I don't really like the jarring music cut here. And I feel like this scene could have been edited slightly better. I do like the Cyberman scene here at the end, and I quite like the transition that I managed to do through the shadow into the actual Cyberhead. I think that works really well.
The first element was lost. The Doctor is still in possession of the piece. Our time travel capabilities need to be enhanced. We must find the other pieces before the Doctor and ensure that the cyber planet is constructed here. And if necessary, the Doctor will be killed, and it will be procured by force.
And that's the end of the main episode, really. This is the only story that has a next time at the end, though, because...
Anywhere.
I mean, so basically everything in this next time is all that was filmed for Engulf at the time.
I've always wanted to see some history. Your wish is my
so there wasn't really anything else I could have put in it. But I think it serves the purpose well enough. Everything in here is from the pre-titles. But you get a good enough idea of what the episode will actually be about.
Burns to the ground.
And that's that one done. I think as an episode one, I managed to set everything up fairly well. Obviously, we had our voice actors there. I hope you've enjoyed listening to this commentary and enjoyed what I thought about the episode. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you on another commentary soon.